But now Ted Courtney returns for a new series of Aspects of Opera.
Good evening, and you're all very welcome to join me, Ted Courtney, for a new series of Aspects of Opera. Tonight's masterpiece by Rossini is called La Cenerentola, but you might know this famous girl Cenerentola as Cinderella. You know, the good girl who triumphs over evil, which is why the opera is also known as La Bontà in Trionfo, goodness triumphant. Now, for the next 40 minutes or so, I shall refer to my favourite female character as Cinderella, and her real name, of course, is Angelina. Opera buffa, as this is, was a collaboration, Rossini the music, Ferretti the libretto. Do you know, from its first appearance in Rome 1817, it was more popular than The Barber of Seville, written a year earlier. But for the past while, The Barber of Seville has taken over. Maybe it's time for Cinderella to return to the fore. Who knows? Now, we must remember that this is Italian opera, and in Italy there is no such thing as an ugly girl. So Cinderella's two sisters, Clorinda and Tisbe, are cruel, not ugly. Neither will you find a fairy godmother or stepmother, or indeed a glass slipper. Otherwise, the story is exactly the same. Now let us listen to part of the overture. And for those of you who find this music familiar, the overture is the same as his earlier opera, La Gazzetta. We'll take it from this magnificent dominant seventh in the orchestra. Don Magnifico has two daughters, Clorinda and Tisbe. He also has a stepdaughter, Cinderella or Cenerentola. Now the curtain rises, we see a shabby old room in the Baron's mansion, with bedroom doors left and right, and a fireplace in the middle. The doors belong to the sisters Clorinda and Tisbe, and the fire is tended to by Cinderella. And of course, she is at the beck and call of two very demanding sisters. Clorinda is trying out a chasse. Now, what's a chasse? You know, those hoops that hold out a dress. And Tisbe is strategically placing flowers around her body to make herself even more pretty, while poor Cinderella is trying to get the fire going to make coffee. Now here, Rossini blends both Clorinda and Tisbe's voices together in harmony after each has had a chance to, how shall I say, limber up vocally. Bum, 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 bum. No. And listen to the delightful touches of brass fanfare at the coda as Rossini rounds off the piece.
Struggiolare voglio
And now Cinderella singing, as it were, to herself. Una volta c'era un re, once there was a king who was lonely, to a pizzicato accompaniment. Now you could call this aria a sort of identifying tune for Cinderella, or leitmotif, if you like that sort of word, but she never really gets to finish it. The cruel sisters tell her to stop it. And when she tries to sing it again, once there was king says, and they sing, and twice, and three times, e due, e tre, oh, they're so wicked. But they're disturbed by a loud knock, and they exclaim together, chi sarà? Chi sarà? They have to close your eyes and imagine this scene. Who is it? Well, it's Alidoro. He's disguised as a beggar. Alidoro is the tutor to Prince Charming, or Don Ramiro. And eventually, he asks for a little bit of charity. They tell him to get out. But Cinderella gives him a drink, and he says, this will serve you very, very well.
Questo po' di colazione.
More than a hint of the Barber of Seville there, don't you think? Now, did you hear the cruel sisters ordering him out? If they only knew who he was. Only Cinderella offers him food and drink, to which he replies, "Maybe heaven will reward you ere nightfall." And yes, if there is magic here at all, here it is. The courtiers arrive to invite the girls to get ready for the arrival of the prince. And this, I think, is the best example of tenor harmony since I played the soldiers' chorus in Faust last year. Now, this, it isn't music, it's magic. Not only does Rossini treat us to one of the best male choruses ever, but later to a vocal quartet, the three girls and Alidoro, with a counterpoint in the woodwind and Alidoro's ostinato. Now, I'm glad you didn't see that because it's just too intoxicating. I'd be giving you far too much. You see, they all step in time to this hoppy rhythm. It's like a moving picture by Caravaggio. Now, the girls run up to Don Magnifico to tell him the news, but they have awakened him from a lovely dream and he's angry. But he soon cheers up when the girls tell him the news of the prince and marriage.
Magnifico mio sogno, mi veniste a sconcertar, mi veniste a sconcertar, irripodia, mi vergogno, come son mortificate degne figlie d'un barone. Via silenzio ed attenzione, state il sogno, state il sogno a meditar. Mi sognai che il fosco è chiaro, un bellissimo somaro, un somaro ma solenne, quanto un tratto, o che portento, sulle spalle accento accento, sulle spalle accento accento, gli spuntarono le penne, gli spuntarono le penne, ed in aria scivolò. Ed in cima campanile, come trono si fermò, ed in cima campanile, come trono si fermò. Si sentiano per di sotto le campane a dindonar, dindon, 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 dindon. Col cicicciucciu di botto mi veniste a risvegliar, col cicicciucciu di botto mi veniste a risvegliar, col cicicciucciu di botto mi veniste a risvegliar. Ma d'un sogno s'intralciato, ecco il simbolo spiegato. Ma d'un sogno s'intralciato, ecco il simbolo spiegato. La campana suona a festa, allegrezza in casa è questa. Quelle penne siete voi, quel gran volo crebbe a Dio. Resta l'asino di voi, ma quell'asino son io. Chi vi guarda vede chiaro che il somaro è il genitor, il somaro è il genitor, il somaro è il genitor.
Now, here is where Prince Charming, Don Ramiro and Cinderella meet. He's disguised as his own equerry, entering hesitantly and looking around. Listen to that music. When they meet, Cinderella, humming now a familiar tune, with cup and saucer in hand, when she comes face to face with Ramiro, drops everything. When he sees her, he sings, a sweet something sparkled in those eyes of hers. Then Rossini blends both voices together, both in harmony, then in phrase and counterphrase, to show that Cupid has indeed struck. Tutto è deserto, amici.
Tutto è deserto, amici. Nessun risponde. Oh. età simulata sembianza le belle osserverò. Ne viene alcuno, eppurmi di speranza il sapiente alidoro, che qui, saggia e vezzosa, degna di me trovar saprò la sposa. Sposarsi e non amar. Legge tiranna, e nel miglior dei miei giorni, alla difficil scelta mi condanna. Cerchiamo, vediamo. Che cos'è?
Che batti cuore?
Forse un mostro son io?
Sì, no, signore.
Un soave non so. Quegli occhi scintillò, un soave non so che in quegli occhi scintillò.
Don Magnifico is convinced that his financial troubles are over. In a drawing room in the Prince's Palace, we see a table with writing materials, and Don Magnifico, having tasted 30 different barrels of wine, is in appropriate form. Now here again, the male chorus of tenors balance beautifully his bass voice, aided of course by 30 hefty glasses of wine, I suppose. The introduction is on the horns, ba-boom, ba-boom. Is echoed by the woodwind, followed by male chorus. When Magnifico embarks on his aria here, you'll be treated to counterpoint worthy of even Mozart.
Ora figgetelo per la città.
Premio bellissimo di piacere, anche mio Malaga si beve. Premio bellissimo di piacere, anche mio Malaga si beve. Anche mio Malaga si beve. Premio bellissimo di piacere. Anche mio Malaga si beve.
Well, small wonder why he's called Don Magnifico. He is magnificent. Well, you know the rest. Prince Charming, or Don Ramiro, chooses Cinderella for his wife, much to the great annoyance of Magnifico, Clorinda, and Tisbe, because remember, she's only his stepdaughter. But eventually they bow to the triumph of goodness, and she naturally is magnanimous in victory. A slight change of aria now. Cenerentola, Cinderella, is now supported by the chorus as befits her new state. And you might even hear the soprano voice of Clorinda in the chorus with brass fanfare, not sadly in the limelight as she might have wished. And the music gives way to what I can only call a gavotte. Now, a gavotte is 4/4's answer to the waltz. And her voice, that of a princess, and naturally coloratura. So, till we meet again next week, good listening and good night.
Aspects of Opera was presented by Ted Courtney and produced by John Hughes. But in our concert now, the Chamber Orchestra of Europe, conducted by Niklaus Arnoncourt, plays music by Mendelssohn and Schumann. Later we'll hear Schumann's Spring Symphony, the Symphony No. 1, and before that, Mendelssohn's Italian Symphony. But first, a magical overture by Mendelssohn to a magical tale, Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream. Mendelssohn was only 18 when he wrote this overture in 1826. His incidental music for the play, scored for voice, chorus and orchestra, came 17 years later. The overture, in normal sonata form, includes music that's descriptive of incidents or characters in the play. The soft wind chords at the beginning and end hint at the atmosphere of the woodlands, where much of the action takes place. The fairies are represented by the rapid motion of the high violins. The unmistakable hee-haw figure clearly mimics bottom with an ass's head, while an expressive second subject stands for the youthful pairs of lovers. The whole work is exquisitely scored with novel effects, capturing brilliantly the spirit of Shakespeare's world. So here it is, the overture to A Midsummer Night's Dream by Mendelssohn.
Thank you.